But he remarried 5 years later, and Anna Maria's life changed, giving her time to help the needy and delve into the writings of the early fathers of the church and the imitation of Christ. Her father's assignment in Berlin gave Anna Maria first-hand experience working in the slums of that city of nearly 500,000 people. She realized that the churches and public agencies were not caring for hundreds of abandoned and homeless children. Because of hard times, women turned to prostitution in startling numbers. Illegitimacy ran rampant, and babies were discarded. Infant mortality skyrocketed in Berlin, as well as in other European cities, in the mid to late 19th century. Anna Maria went to work in Cologne in 1886, and despite warnings from her father, she took steps towards converting to Catholicism. It was in the Church of the Apostles in Cologne on October 30th, 1888, that the parson's daughter became a Catholic when she was 33 years old. That step meant the immediate loss of her job in Cologne and the loss of many old friends, but she wrote that she was convinced she was doing God's will. New friends came quickly in Catholic circles, especially those with social concerns similar to Anna Maria's. 3 years after her conversion, she opened the first home for the homeless for children in Berlin. It was August 2nd, 1891. On December 8th of that year, the Blessed Sacrament was reserved in the first little chapel in Berlin. She called this the happiest day of my life. She named her small group the Servants of the Divine Heart of Jesus. Historically, they're credited with founding the first Catholic kindergarten in Berlin. But it was more than just a classroom or preschool. Anna Maria introduced a family system in her home. 16 to 20 children were grouped into a family under the direction of one of her Servants of the Divine Heart of Jesus. They took the place of a mother.
Home for the homeless, that was her slogan.
Anna Maria's family spirit caught on. More women and girls volunteered to help. Donations came in as word spread around Germany of the work of the Servants of the Divine Heart of Jesus. She opened more homes in and around Berlin. In November 1896, Anna Maria's group started to observe the rule of Carmel. Instead of fasting, they offered their work. In 1897, they were known as the Carmelite Sisters, Servants of the Divine Heart of Jesus. By then, Anna Maria's group included 50 sisters, more than 200 children, and 6 homes. But all was not well with church officials in Berlin. They forbade the new Carmelite sisters to wear their habits in public, accused their foundress of disobedience, and complained that her homes were more Protestant than Catholic. Anna Maria Tauscher, the convert from Lutheranism, was now known as Mother Mary Teresa of St. Joseph. She asked to open a mother house for her new order in Berlin and was turned down. In fact, she was unable to open a novitiate anywhere in Germany. In Holland, a bishop granted her permission for a temporary novitiate at Sittard, near Cologne, Germany. It was 1904 when Mother Mary Teresa went to Rome and was granted permission to open a mother house and novitiate in the Diocese of Frascati, outside of Rome. The community moved into an abandoned estate in the hills at Rocco de Papa, and Pope Pius X blessed the sisters personally. Mother Mary Teresa wrote, "From Berlin, the fortress of Protestantism, divine providence has guided the Carmel of the Divine Heart of Jesus to the Rock of the Holy Father. The Carmel was to be founded on this rock." A 13-year struggle finally ended. Her religious community had its ecclesiastical approbation at last, and the name was officially Carmelites of the Divine Heart of Jesus, a branch of the Carmelites of St. Teresa. Word of the new community's work with the homeless brought appeals from many places. In 1900, Mother Mary Teresa went to England. She opened 2 homes and a novitiate there in 2 years. Next, it was Switzerland with 1 home in 1902. Then she was allowed to reopen her convent in Sittard, Holland in 1906. The next year, she went to Hungary, where she founded 4 homes for children in a span of 7 years. When Mother Mary Teresa set out for the United States in 1912, her community was operating 20 homes in 13 dioceses throughout Europe, caring for some 1,900 children. And the Carmelites of the Divine Heart of Jesus numbered 201 sisters, 50 novices, and 82 postulants. The trip to America was pleasant, but it was 1912 and the days before World War I, and Mother Teresa learned that Germans were not always popular. She received cordial receptions in New York, Cleveland, Chicago, and Milwaukee, but only the Archbishop of Milwaukee, Sebastian Messmer, gave his permission for the Carmelites to stay there. They took over an abandoned diocesan boys' home for their first apostolate in the Western Hemisphere in December of 1912. But from across the border in Canada came an open invitation to Mother Mary Teresa to go to Toronto, and the sisters there today pick up the story of their foundress's travels in the New World.
As you know, she had difficulty getting in America to many places. Here she was invited by Bishop Neil McNeil.
In the very beginning, I think he lent his carriage and toured around the city with her, and she looked all over the place. And then later on, she must have went on her own, because she found this place and went back and told someone that she'd found this place that she thought was ideal. And it turned out to be owned by the Archdiocese.
We have the distinction of being the only or the first home where Mother Foundress was invited to come in America. The bishop didn't refuse her, he asked her to come. So that's our boast here. Anyway.
Back to the States, Mother Mary Teresa went to East Chicago, Indiana, and opened a children's home in two small frame houses in a poor Hungarian neighborhood. The bishop heartily approved. Then Bishop John Shaw called. Founded more homes and won approval for moving the Carmelite Mother House from Rocca de Papa in Italy to Sittard in Holland. A new and present Mother House building was built and blessed in 1924. It was there that Mother Foundress spent her final years, and some sisters still remember her from the 1920s and 30s when they first entered the Carmelites in Europe.
She met me once, and then she says, "I understand that you are going to the novitiate." I said, "Yes, Mother." And then she said, "Well, I tell you, I just will warn you. They are very strict, but stick it out and don't run away."
We have to go to Charlottenburg for our novitiate training. And when she told us that, oh, she gave us such motherly advice and so patient. I remember that very well.
I remember She took me by the arm, like I would do like this, and took me by the arm and put me around, and she asked me, she said, you're French, aren't you? I say, no, mother, I'm not French. I could say that in German, but you wouldn't understand, would you? I'm from Westphalen. Then she said, where's your father from? I said, he's a Westphalen. And your mother, Westphalen also. And she was satisfied. And she said, well, try to be good and brave, she said. And then she went to the next person.
Stick it out, she said, don't run away, they are very strict. She said that very seriously to me, you know. Yeah, well, I stuck it, you know, I didn't feel
like,
no, I didn't feel like running away, no.
In 1931, one young postulant from Bavaria was put in charge of the front door at the mother house in Sittard. Sister Mary Lucretia recalls Mother Mary Teresa.
So she gave me the little key and I opened there and I brought the mail. Mm-hmm. That I did nearly every day.
But the story of Mother Foundress's teapot is one that Sister Mary Benedicta, a native of Hungary, will never forget. It occurred at the mother house in Holland in 1935.
I met Mother every single day. I brought her a glass of buttermilk in the morning at 10 o'clock, and at lunchtime, tea. Mother always met me with a smile, warm smile. I was happy to do this for Mother until one day I dropped the teapot and fell and it broke into pieces. And I thought I committed a crime. The bought one, similar to it, but was not the same. So I was scared when next day I come in the factory with shaking hands, I put it on the table. I said, Mutter, I broke the other one. She didn't scold me. She looked at the teapot and said, it's much nicer than the other one. I like it. This was the first time I experienced her kindness. And you know, in Sittard, in a mother house, there is a glass case. Behind there are items Mother used to use before when she was living. And on one of the shelves, there is a little teapot, my teapot. And in my eyes, this is the most beautiful and cherished souvenir of a saintly mother foundress.
The end of Mother Mary Teresa's long and fruitful career on earth came in this room at the Mother House in Sittard at 2:30 in the morning of September 20th, 1938. She was 83 years old. Burial was in the cemetery of the Mother House, but her body was later moved to a chapel built and designed for it inside the Mother House. Her life paralleled that of her model, Saint Teresa of Avila, or as the Carmelites call her, Saint Teresa of Jesus. Both were women with a mission within the ancient Carmelite tradition. Saint Teresa reformed and revived the Carmelite order in the 16th century, and Mother Mary Teresa expanded the Carmelite mission into an active apostolate in the 19th and 20th centuries. In 1953, the ordinary process for Mother Mary Teresa's beatification and canonization was solemnly opened by the Bishop of Roermond, Holland. As the Carmelites observe their 100th anniversary, most of the homes founded by Mother Mary Teresa, with only a few exceptions, are still operating. The apostolates continue, and her sisters today observe the anniversaries of each home with a special celebration. In September 1988, the home founded by Mother Mary Teresa in East Chicago, Indiana, marked its 75th anniversary, and Bishop Norbert Goggin offered the Mass of Thanksgiving.
The Carmelite women have been raised on the gospel, the word of God, taught to them through that great genius of womanhood, Saint Teresa of Avila.
At the time of the anniversary, an open house reception brought the 42 girls staying at the home in touch with former students and nuns.
I remember they were very strict. We learned discipline. We learned the value of things.
In Texas, another children's home founded by Mother Mary Teresa celebrated its Diamond Jubilee in October of 1989. Archbishop Patrick Flores Kahn celebrated the Mass of Thanksgiving in the tiny auditorium of the original building from 1914, and the Archbishop brought with him a papal blessing that Pope John Paul sent for the sisters from Rome.
It's amazing how so often a great politician or a great community leader would point to this place and said, I started here. And it's here that they got their foundation, and it's here that they got the love that